When you hear the words Austell, Georgia, what do you think? Maybe an old town road? Or a ghost town? A long forgotten stop along the railroad. Maybe you think it's a quiet suburb, just 15 minutes west of Atlanta. Maybe you think it's a country city on the outskirts of the metropolitan area. In reality, it's a little bit of all those things. A relic of old Georgia, sitting at the intersection of yesterday and tomorrow. The community itself is made up of what you would think of as stereotypical Georgians, along with a new lifeblood of diversity seen all around the metro area. But what you might not expect from this sleepy southern town is that in a few hours, this near-vacant strip mall parking lot will transform into a festival dedicated Georgia. To a West Coast icon, the Lowrider.
Georgia.
We on the grind,
Georgia.
All the time, it ain't nothing on my mind, but
Georgia.
We ain't playing with you. We on the grind,
Georgia.
All the time, it ain't nothing on my mind, but
Georgia.
We ain't playing with you.
Country name, country slang, fiends at the liquor store. Lack cruising, crap shooting, 50 on the 10 or 4. Overcast, the forecast shows clouds from plenty. And we ready for war in the state of
Georgia.
Dirty words, dirty birds, it's mean in this dirty South. You ever disrespect it, and we'll clean out your dirty mouth.
For the Lowrider magazine, Krazy Guy show, glad for the event. It's been like 20-something years since Lowrider magazine has been back to the East Coast. Well, not even down in Miami, but back on the East. And we here from South Carolina and North Carolina to support Krazy Vatos and Lowrider Magazine show. Psyched from Loyalty Car Club. I got a 1981 El Camino with the Monte Carlo LS front end on it. You'll see it out there though.
The night before the Lowrider Magazine Super Show, it was kind of like a bowl game, but for lowriders in and around the city. And this was like the tailgate event before the big show. The crowd was excited, music was playing, food and drinks were available from local vendors. There were fans of lowriders, local car clubs, out-of-state visitors, and the stars of the night, hoppers. As the name suggests, hoppers are lowriders specifically designed for hopping. Like many lowriders, they have hydraulics installed to help lower and raise the vehicle as the driver sees fit. The difference between these ones and show cars is that the goal is to jump one to all four of the tires off of the ground. The bodies, axles, wheels, all take a beating. The crew not only needs to know how to operate the hydraulics, but they also have to be skilled mechanics, able to fix issues on the fly, to compete and also leave afterwards. Tonight's showcase, two clubs putting their best hoppers to the test. The hometown team, Obsession Car Club. The challengers, a club from Chicago. As the contest begins, the team from Chicago seems to be having some mechanical issues. And the team from Atlanta seems to be having some home field advantages. The Chicago team gets their setup back working. And with that, stands their car on the bumper. The team from Atlanta tries, but it can't quite get their car to sit on its bumper like the team from Chicago. Well, it's getting late, and although the police seem to be enjoying the show just as much as the crowd is, it seems about time pack it up, and get ready for the big show tomorrow. Walking into the Super Show was like stepping into a living museum. One part history museum, one part art museum, one part cultural museum. It was a swirl of bright colors, intricate patterns, wild textures, and lifelike murals. Vehicles range from completely modified works of art to immaculately kept antique rides. There were categories for engraving, paint jobs, hydraulic setups, even for specific car classes. Lowriders weren't the only vehicles on display either. Rare classic cars, beautiful sports cars, trocas, choppers, trikes and beach cruisers, pedal cars, even model cars, all of them had a place on the floor. Along with the vehicle displays, a steady stream of musical acts entertained the crowd, including an artist from the club responsible for the show, Lolo KV, with Krazy Vato's Car Club. And of course, it wouldn't be a Super Show without a performance from Chicano artist Little Rob. Possible to escape the influence Chicanos and Mexicans have on the lowrider culture. From the paint styles and designs, silver and gold engravings, fabric choices, flags, license plates, club plaques, even car names reflected Mexican and Chicano culture. That being said, every vehicle on display at the show reflected the individual diversity that exists in the lowrider culture. Lowriders come from different states, represent different ethnic backgrounds, came up differently, but they're all brought together by one commonality, their love of the culture.
Streetz from the Krazy Vato's Car Club. Today we made history in Atlanta. Lowrider Magazine, we brought them to Atlanta for the first time ever in Southeast Georgia. Never, ever. It's the first annual. I guarantee you next year, more people are gonna come because this is something to talk about. We made history.
These are more than vehicles. They're statements. They tell the world who is driving, why they do it, what they're like. What they like. Some are memorials to loved ones. Some are snapshots into the past. And some are clear messages to others. Displays shed more light into the history of the driver, the clubs, even the car itself. Some displays were simple, some elaborate, but each one was carefully designed to highlight the beauty of the story behind each build. At the end of the day, clubs and owners were recognized for their efforts with a trophy ceremony. Winners were given plaques from Lowrider Magazine. the highest honor a lowrider can receive. Proud owner Psych, along with a few other members of Loyalty Car Club in North Carolina, were able to walk away with some trophies.
Second place in the El Camino class. Said very appreciative to Lowrider Magazine and Krazy Guy for giving Atlanta Super Show, and you know, hopefully it'll be back next year. And we're very excited. Hopefully it will be, but we're just very excited and thankful to everyone, all the spectators that came out, all the rappers, all the models, just everyone, the vendors. Just want to thank everybody for throwing a super nice event. You know, just want to say, you know, low riding for life, you know what I mean?
After a long, positive day, the lowriders began to head out. Back to their respective homes, many of which were here in Metro Atlanta, a city known for big wheels and burnouts.
Mister, how could you afford this? Okay. This looked like some shit that we saw up in Surface. Gather around, kids, I got new words for y'all today. If it ain't 22s or better, then it's move on.
To put it that way, because we do love cars. I like big rims, no matter what.
And then you get to see the people who say, hey, this is Atlanta, we're used to the big rims.
I think what's more associated with Atlanta is probably like race cars, probably, you know, like Hellcats, Scat Packs and all that.
I did get into Hondas for a minute. You know, I was very into like the stance culture and everything, and it was exciting for me because it was different.
I mean, I have other cars. I mean, even that car is 400 horsepower. I don't even drive that shit. It's my driver for the jail. It's just stupid. You just press gas, you're going fucking 160 miles an hour.
Regardless of the type of vehicle that is associated with Atlanta, everybody could agree that lowriders aren't.
It's the least expected thing, but it was there. It's been here since forever. I recall early 2000s, late 90s was when it was first starting to start over here because people were moving from California and different parts of the world, and they were bringing the culture over here and they wanted to start something local.
In the early 90s here in Georgia, did a three-way motion like that. I got a fat ticket, almost went to jail. But the other people at lowriding at that time, I hear people went to jail. They get harassed because the guard, the way that it looks, that, you know, they thought you're a gangster or whatever, or you're a drug dealer or something like that.
When the older people, they stop me and say, hey, I remember back in 93, that's what they used to do. We used to ride small rims like that. So then I get a history lesson because I wasn't here in 93.
When we started lowriding back in the early, middle 90s, let's just say, we always took it to downtown after 11. We would meet at the Varsity, and then we would go for the cruise down Peachtree Street here in Atlanta. It was wide open. We would literally take over the streets, both oncoming and going, all four lanes, one way, you know, with lowriding.
It was a little hard to figure out exactly when lowriding came to Atlanta. With that being said, there was no debate as to who the first club was.
I think Latin Low might be the first one.
If I'm not mistaken, car club named Latin Low from Marietta.
You can't talk about lowriding in Atlanta without speaking with members of the Latin Low Car Club. And Greg Salazar is a perfect person to talk to. Raised in Marietta, he's been around Latin Low his whole life.
As a kid growing up, that was, you know, it was fascinating to me. You know, like cars going up and down. I could tell you some of the, like, the best moments being in a car. My dad driving, we would be like in some random parking lot and he would just be like, all the guys in the back, move over to the right side of the seat, and then he would just drop, you know, one of the corners, and then here we are three-wheeling just through some random parking lot or in the middle of the street. And I don't know, man, that, like, that feeling and that like just joy that you got from it, it was kind of life-changing for me.
Greg not only is the son of the co-founder and current president of Latin Low, but he is also the proud caretaker of his mother's beloved 63 Impala.
So I got into lowriding through my dad and my mom. You know, I got a hold of the Impala, which is my mom's car. And I don't know, so something just told me one day, just keep going with it. Thanks to my dad, he's actually shown me a lot throughout the years.
Greg's father, Ben Salazar, is a pioneer in Atlanta lowriding. And he learned all about lowriding growing up in his childhood home of Texas.
Well, I moved over to a Grand Prix. It was my very first lowrider in Houston, Texas. I'm from the Second Ward.
When he moved to Georgia in the early 90s, he brought the love of the culture with him.
Well, you know, Atlanta Low was not necessarily founded in 93 just because, but it was really a drive and a part of the culture that I lived when I was a lot younger. When I got here to Georgia, I talked to Vice President Joe, who's not here present today, but, and Joe was in high school, Marietta High School at the time, and he asked me about it, and I said, you know what, if you buy a motor for it, you know, we'll, I'll give you the car. So we traveled together alone, you know, to Houston, put a motor in it, and drove it back. When I got here, Joe asked me straight up, the hydraulics are in the trunk. We're gonna put them on or what? And I said, that's up to you, you know. He was in high school here, I wasn't, you know. I was already working my life away, raising kids. We lifted the car back up, you know, put hydraulics back on it. Joe turned a lot of heads in high school in 1993. There was nothing here in Georgia that reflected the West Side culture from Texas to Arizona all the way to California. Nothing like that here.
And you know, my mom's from California, so.
When I was like 10 years old, we moved to Los Angeles.
Yeah.
That and just living in California itself, it kind of pulls you towards that. If you're you know, Mexican or Chicano, Hispanic, whatever.
Yeah, I was born and raised in LA for like 20 years. When I lived in Union and 12th Street. I am from Korean.
David Kim relocated to Georgia in the early 90s under the suggestion of his parents. And after spending several decades as a Gwinnett County resident, he's now a member of the Living It Up Car Club, proudly representing his new home. He may not seem like your typical lowrider, but he's no stranger to the culture. A son of Korean immigrants to California, David was raised around Latinos and lowriders.
So fucking chulo all my life. Coming in here, just like that, it was like, what the fuck? So I got a lot of fights. My dad's a pastor, so he wanted to go somewhere to live comfortably. You know, we live in a fucked up neighborhood that you wake up, your car's not there. I didn't want to. My parents moved out here to help, like, the Koreans out here that don't speak English, the senior citizens, so they could go with their living. So later on, he said, you know, it's better out here. They just came over and said, let's just go to a different place to live. And I drove for 3 days and here I am. I love it. I mean, the people are nice. It took me a while to sleep because it was so quiet. But when we moved here, there was no Asians at all. I think he's another Asian guy that I know. I don't know any other one else. There's one in North Carolina named Tran, but his shit's type 2. And all the Asian guys from the South, he has a convertible, just looks just like mine. And the one in North Carolina is just like mine, but with more stuff. So these are the only Asian guys that I know that has lowrider, but they all got Impala. I always wanted Impala, but I never thought it could be a dream.
David may not strike you as a stereotypical lowrider, but he, like all other lowriders, has spent countless hours and dollars on his passion.
Just on the hydraulic setting up, I probably spent more than $20,000.
redo it and redo it. I didn't like it. I did other things to it. And just parts that's like chrome and engraved, triple chrome. Just little parts that only cost maybe $50. This is engraved. Now it's like $1,500.
It's an expensive love. I would say, if you love your girl and she doesn't love your lowrider, get rid of your girl. Real talk, get rid of your girl, because y'all gonna end up fighting anyway. Because there's so much money that goes into it, from the rims to the paint jobs. The paint jobs are almost $7,500 and up. And that could be a start of a college tuition for your kid. You could put that in the CD somewhere, but we putting that on a paint job. So my thing is, if you have a love for lowriders, it's inside of you. You can't just jump into this. This ain't something that I would tell anyone to just jump in right now. If you haven't loved this since you were a kid, this might not be for you. Like, for real. This car is over $100,000. Right now, it's worth $110,000, and it's worth every penny.
Like many of his fellow lowriders, Streetz from Krazy Vato's Car Club has had a passion for lowriders since before he could drive. Raised in New York and Miami, one might not expect him to be a lifelong lowrider, but he has been around the culture since he was a child.
Yeah, Puerto Rican and black, but I mean, a lot of Puerto Ricans that I know, they have lowriders. A lot of my black family members had lowriders. So it's not just me. It was people that's fully black that were into the culture, deep, deep, changing their batteries, hitting the switches. Like, I grew up around them doing that shit. So I seen it. But we started off with models, and I had a lowrider bike in 94. I begged my mom to give me this lowrider bike. It was $900, already decked out, and I couldn't get it. She was like, I'll get you the one for like $250. So I got a green lowrider bike, rode that thing to school every day till I broke the damn metal off, till it rusted out in my house.
Even for smaller vehicles like models, pedal cars, and bikes, builds can reach thousands of dollars in investment. From specialty chrome to engraved pieces, paint jobs, and accents, these vehicles are living artworks, never truly finished.
You could say that, and then, yeah, it's never truly done, because someone sits there and they're like, all right, I got my rims, I got my speakers, I got my interior, I got my paint, I got everything on it. What am I missing? And they're like, you know what? Let me put something else. They're like, let me put a little bit of engraving or chrome on it. And like, you know what? I want some more and some more. It's a never-ending process, but that's the good thing about it.
Edgar, with Los Aztecas Car and Bike Club, has a good understanding of the demands of lowriding. Just like Greg Salazar with Latin Low, Edgar's father was lowriding well before he was born. And at 17 years old, he is one of the youngest lowriders in the city.
I mean, I could say that I'm one of the younger, but I've seen freaking little mocosos around here, you know, getting involved in the game. But it's always good to see people my age, or even people younger than me, interested in the cars, because, you know, that's what it's all about. We want to keep this thing going. And my dad got me into lowriding. He definitely got me into lowriding. Since I could walk, probably I was over there. He was over there trying to teach me how to shine the chrome on, because this bike originally was all twisted. And he would just sit me down right there, grab the little rag. He's like, all right, yeah, wipe it right here, wipe it right there, and would sit there and work on it. This right here is both of ours. We share it. He has his, and then we have ours. This is ours right there. Yeah. That's our passion right there. He wanted to represent the culture, and he wanted to represent his ideas. He wanted to make his ideas come into reality. Yeah, we had to get different pieces brought from Mexico. Everything's specifically made in the DF. This is his very first car, lowrider car. Very first lowrider car. He wanted to start from scratch. He didn't really have ideas in his head the way he wanted to make it. And he got it original. He got it intact, perfect intact. And then everything else slowly came to it. He's like, all right, now I want to do this to it. I'm going to slap some rims on it. I want to put some chrome on it. I want to change the color maybe a little bit lighter. I want the top like this, the interior, everything. I feel like everything just comes slowly after you're progressing. It's the love that you find into it. I don't think there's a specific reason why he made it the way it is, the color or the designs, but I feel like it was his inspiration and hard work that was being put into it. After he changed one thing, he was like, you know what? I'm going to change another thing. And he's like, oh, it's looking good. I want to change another thing. And I feel like that's everybody in the Lowrider game. You know, they put one thing on the car, and they're like, you know what? I think I need a paint job. Ah, it looks good like this, but, you know, I think I'm gonna put some speakers in it. I want the music banging. It's a lot of things that are into it.
The amount of time spent, attention to detail, and money required for these builds is only made more impressive when you realize most of these lowriders are working 9-to-5 jobs to afford their passion.
Yo, me está preguntando si, como que hace el trabajo.
Framing.
See this framing, construction work.
I do construction work. Ever since I moved here, actually, when I got here, I started doing like brick work, masonry work with my uncle and my dad. That's what we learned to do, and that's what I've been doing ever since.
We also had a body shop for paint and upholstery. We did a lot of that too. And with great help of Greg growing up around me, you know, do this, do that. He was a gopher, but now it's paid off because now he works for a Lexus dealership. You know, he's doing well for himself.
I'm a parent, I have children. I'm a wife, I cook, I do it all. So I run a child care facility. I have 150 kids. So it's like I'm running a school, but people just don't know behind the scenes that I build this magnificent car that I have behind me. I'm like, I got all these capes on me, but this is something that I enjoy doing.
Shan wears several capes within the lowrider community as well. She's the vice president and co-founder of the Street Mentality Car Club. She's the proud owner of Poison Ivy, her 94 Cadillac Coupe de Ville. And she's also one of only a handful of women lowriders in the city.
And then they asked me as a woman, like, how did you just get into it? It's like, I just did. I always liked cars, so it's just something I always done. I started with my uncle. He showed me how to, you know, change oil and just do like the basic kind of stuff. But I was always around him in the garage and seeing what he was doing or whatever. And then I tried to hook up my own music one time by myself. So I've always been like curious about, you know, how to do things on my own when it comes to my car. But I met my husband and then went to the lowrider scene. I'm like, oh my God, I gotta do this. Like, I want to do this. And that's when I said I wanted my first lowrider. And then that's what we did it. So everybody asked me, are you from here? Are you from LA? I'm like, no, I'm strictly country girl from Georgia.
Even though Shan has been building and driving her own lowriders since the early 2000s, she's not always received the respect she deserves.
Oh, I was just like, let's step outside the box and do something way different with the gator seats, with the green gator seats and stuff.
I'm hopping out of Phantom with an iced out medallion, stallions on both arms, rocks on both charms, my Dominican chick.
Something different. You don't want to give everybody the same old look, the same old thing.
Because hustlers hit the block when police change shifts. New York, California, different toilet, same shit. In Brooklyn, I rock Timberland.
Or it's not even hard on me being a black woman because I haven't experienced that yet in this community, in the lowrider community. I said, but just being a woman, period. You know, a lot of people will look at my car and be like, oh, her husband did that or he built that. No, I built that. I think I ran into one time I had built the car, that yellow car, and I was so excited that I had did that. And I'm sitting back, and I guess nobody didn't see me sitting back in the thing, and guy made a comment that my car didn't look good and all this other kind of stuff. So I didn't say anything. I just sat back, but I was like, it's all good. It's good. Like, I bring it. It doesn't matter to me. But that was really upsetting to me to make that comment when I'm building my own car and other people are not. But this is something that I worked hard on. And then sometimes I do feel like as, you know, men, you need to tell a woman, good job, you built that, good job, you know, because it's not easy.
When talking about women lowriders of Atlanta, it's impossible not to acknowledge the role that Greg Salazar's mother, Sylvia, played alongside her husband, Ben.
So this car has actually been in the family, or my mom's car, since 93, 94. And before she passed away, this was her thing. This was her dream. She was a full-on female mechanic. She did interior. She got under the car. I recently, because I don't know that much about my mom, to be honest. I mean, being at the age I was, I don't feel like I have a full, like, understanding of who she was, you know, what she did. But every once in a while, I'll get a story, you know, from a different source or a different car club, people that knew her 20 years ago. I actually had someone tell me the other day, they saw her get from under a car and she was cleaning the underbelly. And when she came out, she was like completely black.
Through her son Greg, as well as other women lowriders in Atlanta, the torch Sylvia has passed on will be proudly carried into the future.
Women, if you this is what you want to do, go ahead and just go for it. You know, don't let nobody tell you that you can't do anything, because I've did it. I've built two cars that I never ever in a million years thought I'll be, you know, right here where I'm at now, like with a car and a vice president of a club. I actually run a club. I actually make sure things, I facilitate things. So if that's what you want to do, come on, go for it, women. Let's do this. Let's make this happen. I want to ride with more women. That's my car. I built it, and it doesn't matter. So I can sit here and somebody can say something bad about my car, but where's your car? It's just like, it's my car. I don't care what you think or how you feel about my car. It's mine. I built it. I own it. So it doesn't matter what you think.
Interestingly, Shan has found respect and a warm reception from an unexpected group.
I've been riding. I've never had a police like really even try to pull me over, be rude to me or anything like that. Police have always been very receptive, put their thumbs up, tell me to pull over, like, what is that? Can you do that? You know, so the police is, you know, they really like, they help out too. They don't really give us a hard time as well. And that's great.
One key difference between the history of low riding in Atlanta and the history of low riding back west is the existence of friendly relationships between the community and local police departments.
It was new to Atlanta Police Department, and they loved it. They allowed it, you know. We never had a problem with it. It wasn't until we turned over the new millennium, you know, after 2000, where they started wanting to put no cruising signs up here in Atlanta.
That comes from another type of, you know, riding that people be doing in the middle of the streets, burning rubber and doing that. We low and slow. We're no threat to anybody. We just cruise and have a good time, listen to our old school music.
County, right now, we've given so much to them and supported, and they're at our events. We pay them to protect our people while we're at the event trying to enjoy our day. So we give them jobs. We pay them. So it's like there should be no animosity at this point, and they should understand that the lowrider community is not all about violence. It's not about that at all. We are here to enjoy.
Believe it or not, we actually do a show with the police, and we kind of did it so they can get familiar with the lowriders and stuff. So I'm actually one of the judges when they do. Cobb County Police do. They be doing a car show every year too. It's called Ride with the Blue, which they raise money to help like the poor kids that don't have toys and stuff on Christmas. So they raise some money and buy toys and then go give them to the kids. So we help them every year with that show. So we're really tied with them. But then again, it's because we have to put in the work as a club. You know? You can't expect them to respect you or understand what you're doing if you don't actually go with them and show them how it is. So, no, we try to make it to where we can enjoy our cars without having any problems with them, and they kind of understand that.
I want to give back to my police department, you know, personnel, my sheriff department.
And they know that now, so every time they see a car, they know what's about.
As president of the largest club in the city, Lolo KV, like other club presidents, understands the importance of community perception of himself, his club, and lowriders in general.
You had to really be smart who you were hanging out with and stuff like that. But I was always more aiming towards the lowrider than the others, even though I was right there too.
Fostering and maintaining a positive relationship with police and other civic leaders makes putting on events safer and easier. These events are not only for them to enjoy their culture without harassment, but also to provide a welcome service for the community as a whole.
You know, as a club, we put the shows together as a club. So, you know, everybody has a job. Every member has a job on the shows, and that's that's kind of the only work that you have to do.
Hey, this is what our expectations are, you know, and we always require you. We have mandatory shows that you have to be at.
Every year, a parade here in Duluth, and we'll go down the street, we'll throw out candies to the kids. Spend like $200 on candies, goddamn.
And we're now letting other car clubs do their thing. Now I'm sitting back and enjoying them, going to show instead of putting them on.
That's a lot of work.
It's a lot of work. I've talked to some of these presidents, man, and they nod their heads side to side and said, man, I don't know how I got into this. I said, well, live and learn, man. Been there, done that, you know? But I take my hats off to them, you know, because I know what it takes to get it done.
We've probably done one event, and we did it here locally in Canton, and we did a little show there. We invited different clubs, and they all came together and they supported us. In the future, we have bigger plans, hopefully, you know, to do bigger things, but with time and God willing. You know, before we were there, they were also there, and they were getting all the grind going, and then everyone else started grinding too, and everyone started grinding together, and that's what I should be like.
With the amount of work clubs require from their members, it's understandable why some lowriders choose to drive solo.
Man, it's hard to say. Like, I wouldn't mind doing my own thing, but at the same time, the club is dope. And as of right now, I'm glad I'm with a club, you know. And I'm glad where I'm at.
That's when they put the Krazy Vato sticker on my car. So I became the first black Puerto Rican in Krazy Vato.
So a lot of people are not club connected. A lot of them are just independent riders, so yeah.
Although not every lowrider in the city is part of a club, every club member in the city is expected to be a lowrider.
Put the price down, obviously.
Obviously, you gotta have a car on spokes.
Oh, to be part of a club, one, you gotta have a car. Or in the process of building a car.
Of course, there's more to being a club member than simply owning a lowrider. Requirements vary between clubs and range from tangible things like dues and model specifications, to more abstract things like the way one holds themselves.
You know, most car clubs do have club dues, and that helps with when we have to do a big show, we have to travel, or we have our charity event, we can pull from that and, you know, financially to help us do those things outside. It's more contained, it's more business-like, it's more, you know, you have certain things that you know, you have to do in a club, and then you have to act a certain way.
Yeah, we used to collect dues. It wasn't only for car parts, it was for shirts, logos, caps, anything that was related to using inside the car club. Yeah. Landlords structured more of a old school. We like the old flavor, you know. We also, because it's old school, we like to try to keep them, you know, in the 70s or older. We have some in the 90s, but, you know, they keep it old school flavor.
It's like family. You want to bring a gift, kind of thing.
You know, there's other things that go into it, like plaques and everything, obviously, like earning them and different things that are involved with it. But other than that, there's no fee or anything. If you want to represent Aztecas, you know, or here in open air.
We just ask the guy who wants to join the club to come around and hang around with us so that we can get to know him and he can get to know the guys. You know, that's kind of the main thing.
A common theme expressed by lowriders about club membership was the importance of the relationships formed and the bonds they develop.
Right now we're like more like family based. A lot of teamwork, and
family is probably our main role. Family, always family.
The pros of it is, you know, you have a family. You know, that's the main thing, is family.
Not only do lowriders have an immense amount of support within their individual clubs, but there also exists a huge community of support fostered by the unofficial association of clubs in the city.
And it's a lot of support, you know, a lot of support for all the clubs, man, not just from my own club, from all the clubs, even the Krazy Vatos, man. I knew them before I knew my club, and they are super dope. Shout out to Krazy Vatos one more time.
All the other car clubs, it's family. Everyone gets along well. There's a lot of things that people will help you out. They're like, oh, you know, it's looking nice. I love the progress, or we brought something new out. it's always a level of respect and family with the other car clubs, right?
Any other car clubs that has a charity or any kind of things like that is going on, we're there.
We always support each other, and they're always sending us stuff. And we just support each other. That's what we do. I think every car club president as a group, collectively, as presidents, I think that we make it like that. We tell our members, no, we need you to go out here and we need you to support people. That's what we do. We want them to support us. We need you to support them.
And sometimes it's hard to get them together because it's like, for example, today we're doing this quinceañera cruising, right? And maybe another club has another quinceañera cruising. So since we all spread out through the city, up in Winnet, you know, the south and whatever, so everybody kind of does their own thing. And unless it's a big show, then that's when everybody gets together.
It's very, very supportive. Like, I got a lot of love for all the other clubs. I'm still friends with the majority of the presidents nowadays, and they know me since I've been, I don't know, 8 years old, 9 years old. But it's competitive. It's very competitive. I don't know, they're like, everyone thinks their car is the best.
As with any large family, this family isn't immune to rivalries and disagreements. People move away and start new families, and it's hard to get everybody together on one accord. This is something that Greg's father, Ben, has been dealing with from very early on.
There was an organization that we started. There's a few car clubs that were out there, and we started a Georgia Lowrider organization, GLO, G-L-O. And we would meet on issues that clubs had, either at for car shows or for cruising or just basically even club hopping. Club hopping was people jumping from one club to another.
Regardless of the differences, one thing did stand out as something everyone agreed on: being in service to the community.
We don't want you to think that we're just people out here just doing whatever. We do things for our community as well, and I think a lot of people need to see that we do things for our community and help. And we're here today, you know, being supportive of this charity event. So we're all about giving back to our community. Yeah.
It's just using the cars for something good, basically.
Yes. To give something to the community, I think it's an opportunity to share love. And we don't expect anything back. We'll just give it to him with no notice or anything like that, just to give something, just to put more food to our heart, so we could do it again next time. The more we do it, the more they see it, we'll follow their steps and they follow our steps. So it's a give and take situation. And when we see others do it, it gets food to our hearts as well.
I feel like that's the thing that isn't shown too much about the lowriding community is the charity work that goes into it. But every single year, I haven't missed so far, is the Toys for Tots show, where everyone collects toys together and give them to the needy. And, you know, it's a big thing.
Just like the Atlanta Supershow hosted by the Krazy Vatos, the annual Street Mentality Toy Drive is one of the most anticipated events in the community.
We was talking and we was like, okay, so let's do a charity event. And we talked about what kind of charity we wanted to do. And then we started just doing it from there. And I think from us doing a charity event, it just made our name just even bigger. We take it to the heart what we do, and we love what we do. And I think that makes a difference when people see that. Like, we, you know, our toy drive is coming up, and a big charity event. And I mean, we just grind, we go get it. And over the years, we'll gave over maybe 15,000 toys to kids that was in need. So we really like doing things for our community.
This car show is a perfect example of the Lowrider's commitments to charity. Drivers from nearly every Lowrider club, along with those representing other scenes in the city, pull up in mass to support this good cause. Contests range from sound metering, hopping, as well as a grand prize for most toys donated.
This is their number. Look, it's not a big difference.
This is the lowest number we've had in 14 years.
1,913.
Congratulations, Shut Down Boys. They don't want to talk. Y'all ain't gonna clap for us. We'll clap for our goddamn self. Congratulations.
In an era of division, these events have the ability to bring people together. People from different backgrounds, people with different interests, service members. first responders, families from the community. They build bonds between parent and child, bridge the age gap between the new school, the old school, and the older school. In these shows, you see years of experience being applied. And passed down. Everywhere you look, you can't help but see the culture, feel the culture, hear the culture. But what does the future hold for lowriding in Atlanta?
In the future of Atlanta, I think it'll be bigger than what it is now. Newer cars, newer styles.
Where I could see it going, just more modifying, you know, just trying to do something new every year. Like I said before, taking things that don't belong to these cars and putting them in. Why not? You know, do something different.
Now that Lowrider Magazine has put us on the map here because of the amount of cars, of course, a lot of the cars came from out of state too. So a lot of the cars come from, you know, Kentucky, Indiana, Chicago, Florida, you know, Mississippi, Tennessee. You wouldn't think that you'd find these cars there.
That Super Show is what brought a lot of attention and finally got the respect of Atlanta. To have the Lowrider Magazine bring a Super Show to Atlanta means a lot to everybody, because something that was so local and now it's grown and gave recognition to the city, it means a lot. But every year we're hoping that it grows more and more and more, because 30, 40 years ago, whenever everything was starting, and it was small, but you know, we don't want it to be just a California thing, or just a Texas thing, or just an Atlanta thing. I want to be a global thing.
It's about to be big. I mean, like I said, it's a lot of people coming from a lot of different areas. So they're moving here. So I can see it's really getting big. Like, we already got people contacting us, like, left and right, you know, about being in the club and stuff. So it lets us know, like, dang, these are new people that we've never seen or never heard of before. And they're coming and wanting to, you know, want to be a part of our club.
I think our goal as a club is for it not only to stay alive, but to grow, and I think we're seeing it. I think it's coming. Sooner or later, the lowrider movement is going to be a thing in Atlanta. Like, it's going to be well known. One of the proofs is that we made Lowrider Magazine come to Atlanta. So it's like that'll help us put Atlanta on the map as a lowrider community.
Just keeping that culture alive, because that's what it's about. It ain't about the beef. We're not beefing with no car clubs. We want y'all to come roll with us too. That's why we accept every car club. You know, we're not here to compete with you. We know what we got.
But my daughter, she still says, like, oh, you gonna go cruise today? Are we cruising today? And stuff like that. So she still kind of like want to do it a little bit. My son, he do his own thing. But every now and then he say, I want to build one. I'm like, now listen, if we're gonna build it, we're gonna build it. Not just throw something together, because that's not what I do. So you need to get your money right if we're gonna do that.
Most of the lowrider guys that I see at the lowrider car show, their kids are really into it. So I believe we'll have another generation of lowriders.
Yeah, my son is in, and definitely my daughter, she's 5, she loves it. This is her favorite car. I have multiple cars. She loves this one the most. Daddy, can we drive the red car? Daddy, I want to drive the red car. So already she's into this, and she knows how to hit the switches in the other car.
Believe it or not, there's a lot of kids that are really into it, and we try to stay focused so that they can, we'll try to keep them focused on the cars too, so that they can basically keep going with the culture, you know, because that's how we're gonna keep it alive, is with the younger generations. They own their lowrider bikes, so they, you know, they fix up their bikes until it's time for them to get a car. You know?
I feel like more young people, or more youngsters, you can say, need to get involved into it, and you know, get convinced, because a lot of people are like, nah, I don't like them cars. I want to go do something else, but I feel like it should inspire the young community to, you know, pass the torch on, and for them to run with it and show for millions and millions of years, however, you know, this earth lasts, to show everyone, you know, how this all started, and to keep on running with it and keep the culture and the passion.
I just want to say that they're going to continue the trend, you know. Greg being first, you know, and taking care of and keeping up the maintenance on these cars, because he now knows so much about mechanicking that I know that if once I'm gone, he'll make sure that everything is running smoothly.
I've had thoughts, like, throughout years of maybe one day repainting it, but I don't know. I get scared sometimes because it's just, like, there's so much history in the car, and being that it's, like, one of the first lowriders in Atlanta, it's, like, it's an icon. And when they see this car, it takes them back to, like, to the early days of lowriding in Atlanta, because this is the only one that was really there. I think when I think about things today and how long cars last, there's not so many that are from the early 2000s or even the 90s that are still around. I mean, this car was painted 20 years ago.
After their years of dedication to the culture, it's not hard to see the impact that the Salazars and Latin Low have had on the community.
Other car clubs here in Georgia, you know, evolved from Latin Low, and some of the big names out there is Obsessions, Living It Up, Outcast was another one, you know, and if I'm missing one, I forget, the years have gone by. We got nothing but love for the sport and lowriding, and we look forward to continue to grow here in Georgia with the rest of the car clubs, and we salute every single one of them, you know.
This is me hot riding right here in my pro car, and my charger up there. The magazine up there.
After 3 decades of running the oldest lowrider club in the city, Ben Salazar is now ready to pass the keys on.
Next year we'll have a 30-year anniversary, so it's about time that maybe I might step down and Greg might have to either take over with vice president or something like that. I'm not sure.
Ben hasn't just left his mark on his son, his club, or just Atlanta, but lowriding as a whole.
We were inducted to the National Lowrider Hall of Fame in 2018. Me as a person, as a president, for starting lowriding here in Georgia, and Joe Angel for being the painter that he is today.
As Atlanta lowriders enter a new era of recognition, it's important to remember how it all started. It's important to appreciate all of the hard work that it took to build. It's important to recognize their unfailing commitment to the community.
We'd like to say thank you, everybody, for coming out. And next year, we're doing bigger and better things. So come out and support us. It's the first Sunday of November. Every year, we do this event. We want to see you there next year.
It's also necessary to understand why they choose to dedicate themselves to the lowrider lifestyle.
Oh, it's something that, you know, it means a lot to me. You know, we're both interested in the same things, and, you know, I get over here and I can, you know, shine a wheel or, you know, help him clean the car or do something with him. It's a great experience to have with him. It's a great bond. And just to see, you know, him go out there and, you know, enjoy his cars and have a great time at a show and distract themselves from different things, you know, I get happy from it.
My daughter, me and my daughter, she loves everything I do. I'm a superhero, so if I let her know these are superhero dad's cars, then that's what she's gonna grow up to believe.
We mad at each other, and then we go outside in the garage and it's all over. Like, we don't even think about what we're mad at. We're just working on the cars and doing what we love to do.
It feels like you went back in time. You're going back in time and you don't feel that fear. You feel like you're flying, that drowning. But when you're in a regular vehicle every day, you're stressing the road because someone's cutting you off or over. You can't get in a lane because you're fighting to get into that lane. When you're a vehicle like this, everyone's staring at you, so all the roads open. All the fucking roads are open because they're staring at you, which is pretty nice.
The biggest things I like about lowriding is more of the connection that you get with other people. You meet a lot of people, just like I met you. So you get to meet a lot of people, and it's very rewarding in that.
I mean, I get the stories, pulling up to the gas station, older people telling me that their dad had that car, and they remember being a kid in the car. That does something for me. just to feel, because these people probably wouldn't talk to me on a day-to-day. Oh, conversation piece. And now I can talk, and we can have conversations, and they get to see that a guy with tattoos is not what they probably portray me to be. I'm just a down-to-earth person, and we're cool as hell. Lowrider people are cool as hell.
Yeah, you can call it therapeutic. I feel like some people, you know, got things going on outside of work or even at work. You know, they want to get that stress out, come home, and, you know, spend their time with their car and do different things, you know? I feel like you can call lowriding therapeutic.
I don't go to therapy anymore because of the car. So that means it's helping me mentally. So yeah, this helps mentally. So anybody with mental issues, get you a lowrider and just cruise. It'll take a lot of things away.
Another reward too, like I said, you know, people watching the cars and seeing the cars and seeing, you know, actually in lowrider, it's the art. It's the art of it. So when we're building these cars, we're building art. It speaks for itself. So when you see somebody with a car, it might be something not even as, you know, it's spectacular as mine, but we still give everybody props. We try to motivate everybody to, you know, whatever they want to do.
Benefits for me, honestly, it's the learning experience. You know, like, you with lowriders, it's like an ever evolving thing. It's like you can't just like get to a certain point and be like, I'm done. You know, like that's not it. You know, like, it's like you do one thing to a car and it might be like that for like a few months, 6 months, and then you're automatically onto the next idea. And that's what you gotta love about like the culture with us, is that you can constantly keep changing your car and you keep adapting and adapting and adapting. It's like lowriding is like an iPhone. They constantly try to put out a new model every year. For us, it's like we constantly try to put on a new part every year.
Greg will tell you, it's been an experience for him, but on the long run, it pays off because, you know, it's not only something you learn, it's part of your culture, something to look back on, something that, you know, wasn't but a few days at his mom's birthday came up again, and I'm thinking about her, I'm thinking about him, the car and everything, and, you know, it's, you know, heartwarming and heartbreaking at the same time to remember the past, but know that, you know, I look up into the skies and I say, you know, everything's fine down here, you know, and your car too.
Here, and at least it goes towards something that it's an investment, and not just so much about the money, but it's a personal investment towards like the family and towards my mom. You know, I don't know. For me, the wealth is in love. You know,
that wealth of love spills over to anyone who comes out to a show. Anyone who asks for advice on building a car, or even to some random guy with a camera interested in filming a documentary. Nowhere in Atlanta will you find a more accepting and welcoming crowd than those that are part of the ATL lowrider community.
And, you know, we like to get along with different type of cultures in the car club, so that we can be looked at the same way, you know, in growing here in the metro Atlanta area and the state of Georgia.
This is a new city to the lowrider, so the cars take years, you know, for them to build them up and be good. So right now, like I said, it's growing. You know, we do this because we love it, for the love of the culture. We don't do it for the fame or the attention or whatever. You know, we just do it because we love lowriding, and that's kind of our thing. Is like you just come and enjoy it and forget about the other stuff. Just lowrider.
It's gonna get bigger, and it's gonna take over. Like, we're gonna be at every car show. Instead of just a lowrider car shows, we're gonna be at all the car shows. Stonk shows, I'm the one that's doing it. Right now, I'm winning trophies at these donk shows, at these big rim shows. And they're accepting lowriders on their thing. They may have us last, but we're still on the ballot. So we just gotta get there.
Exactly, and with that being said, you know, now that you know, they're there. They just don't, they're like vampires. They only come out at night. That's what I say, you know? So, you know, I don't know if I'm Beatles.
And in the beginning, you know, it's just, nothing with it, and then you finish with it at the end. You can only just be amazed at how it is at the end. So it's just kind of like, wow, I built that. This is something that I did. I really love body work. It's just, it's a quiet moment, and you're doing your thing, and you're perfecting a car. So I really like doing the body work and doing stuff like that. But now everybody's more acceptable to it, and they're so excited. They see you on the road, they wave at you, they thumbs up. Truck drivers honk at you, you know. So, yeah, I think the community really looks after us, and you know, and they really support us, too.
Do what you want to do. You know, always follow your dreams. If you want to do it, you can. You're welcome here in open hands. Whatever you want to do, you know, obviously, anything you want in life, just grind and get it.
Like he said, it was my mom's dream to keep going with this car. I feel like I have to live up to a certain ambition that she might have had. And for me, that's a ever-evolving thing, because since she's not here, she can't tell me to stop. So that means I'm not going to stop now.
You ride 13s till the wheels fall off. That's what it's all about.
Lowriders for life.
We got one more. DJ, bring it back. Run it back one more time. Oh. Hey. Let's go.
I was born in Atlanta, but I live in Canton, practically all over.
I'm from Canton, Georgia.
Are you from Georgia originally?
Atlanta.
Okay.
I've lived here my entire life. Growing up on these streets, walking around, skateboarding.
Angelo from Alabama, but I still rep Atlanta. I've been here since 05. Love.
In my circle, we knew Atlanta was going to be the place. So I said, let me look for a place in Atlanta, let me get a head start.
And then we came to Atlanta. I've been here since I was 16.
I do write down Atlanta to show people that we're here. But we represent the whole culture, the whole world. You know, we're not going to do that little community thing.
The fattest skinny nigga you will ever know. Try to stop my Jetta flow. I let my Beretta blow. At your door and at your chest. Grab your bro and grab your vest. At your home a bloody mess. Fake thugs get blessed with a slug to the chest. R to the I to the E. Pass that baby D beside me. Eastside boys is right behind me. A-town bitch nigga you trying to find me. Sips and roll down to God be. These are the places that I be. These are the faces that I see. I die for the city, don't.
Hopefully, I get to drive it more now.
Hopefully.
You probably
did. Yeah.
Actually, today.
Being modest, we're
trying
to.
I'm not supposed to say it on camera.
Yeah.
Any ideas you could share? Like, are you on it to be a surprise?
We don't never share our ideas. It's like, when you see it, you'll be like, wow, I can't believe it. You thought of that.
You said that the events is one of
the so the Lowrider car show. Allá enfrente no lo van a dejar cargar, güey, deben mover de ahí.
cuesta la vida y se respeta el que gana. Ay, ay, ay.